thank you, everyone, for remaining for this evening's panel. We're joined tonight by a very distinguished group of people who have volunteered to come forward, who have expertise in some of the subjects and some of the broad themes that were addressed in tonight's film. Immediately to my right, to your left, is Dr. Rebecca Wittmann. Dr. Wittmann is a historian and writer and a professor of history at the University of Toronto. She is an expert on the Holocaust, on post-war Germany, the trials of Nazi war criminals, and German legal history, and was one of the figures in tonight's film. Welcome.
Thank you.
Immediately to my left, to your right, is Zaitun Pew. Zaitun is a member of the Rohingya Human Rights Network of Canada and is a doctoral student at York University. Zaitun taught primary and secondary school students in Myanmar for more than 10 years. She now writes and advocates on behalf of Rohingya refugees to create public understanding of the atrocities in Myanmar against the Rohingya people.
Thank you.
And finally, Dr. Sorapong Po. Dr. Po is a professor of politics and public administration at Ryerson University. His interests are in the field of global peace, security studies, and comparative politics, with a focus on the Asia-Pacific region. He will be able to provide insights on mass atrocities from Cambodian history. We'll have a discussion amongst the panelists, and then open matters up for the to the floor for questions from each of you. But I'll begin with a broad question. Each of you has a different perspective on the themes covered in this film. So from those perspectives, can I ask you what you thought were the most important message from this film, not just in the specific prosecution that was dealt with, but in the work that you have done? I think I'll begin with you.
Well, obviously, I feel that the film itself is extraordinarily important. And I just want to point out that the producers here are here, Ricky and Rick, whose names you saw, who really made this film and did really such an extraordinary amount of research. What for me really resonates about this is obviously I'm immersed in this history, mostly in the way that the past is dealt with in Germany. And I've moved away from looking at the legal ramifications because I find them so incredibly depressing and dismal. But I think what you see in this film is the fact that there are many, many different ways for justice to be served. And there's a lot of talk about Nuremberg in the film. But what you also get to understand is that the German system tried and prosecuted many, many, many more thousands of people than were ever tried at Nuremberg, but through a legal system that did a terrible job of showing just how complicit so many people were. And of course, this has incredible implications for our society today, that complicity is a very, very slippery slope that begins with indifference and apathy and can end with joining the SS because it's an easier job than going to the front and murdering people as though it's not happening in your name. And so for me, I think the film shows that in all of its complexities too, this character of Gröning, who is not a very simple perpetrator type, and the victims themselves, who also have very different perspectives. I think it has so many messages, which I'm sure everybody will be thinking about for days to come.
Before I pass on, if I may pick up on one of your points, do you think that the legal system in Germany was unable to deal with the enormities of these crimes because of an aversion to dealing with the crimes, or do you think that the judicial process itself, whether it's in Germany or elsewhere, is incapable of dealing with crimes of such gravity and of such widespread complicity?
Yes and yes. The post-war German legal system, as I mentioned, there's been a great deal of research done on it now, was filled with ex-Nazis, and for very good reason. They were the ones who were serving as jurists, judges, prosecutors in the period before the Nazi period. They served during the Nazi period, and they served after the Nazi period, particularly in West Germany. And they had absolutely no interest in themselves being put in front of a criminal proceeding. And they had the luxury, because they were brought in, and this is largely because there was really nobody else who could be serving as judges and so on. There was places like Bavaria, 80% of the jurists and judges are former Nazis. In certain cities, 100% of them are, because they all get brought back in. I wouldn't necessarily say that they were tried and true. Alan Dershowitz talks about them as real Nazis, and many of them were, because they believed in and created the laws, but many of them felt that they were simply doing their duty, their civic duty as members of the legal community of basically carrying out the law. It didn't really matter what the government was. They were sort of had fluid professional identities. So they weren't necessarily convinced ideological Nazis. What they were attempting to save their own skin. They simply didn't want themselves to come before a legal system, and that bears out. Only two judges are ever tried in post-war Germany, and that's all before 1949 by the German system. So they create a legal system whereby anyone who is a professional can't really be brought before trial and certainly can't be convicted. Now, the question of atonement and justice is, of course, one that I grapple with on a larger basis. You know, what is justice in the case of mass atrocity like this? Is it even possible? And the answer is complex and probably no. But still, there are systems which are better equipped to teaching the lessons of crimes against humanity, and the German system very systematically avoided doing so.
It's very interesting. I have to say, earlier in my career, I was involved somewhat tangentially in the process of de-Ba'athification that was undertaken after the end of the Iraq War. Mm-hmm. And at the end of that war, the victorious powers, not metaphorically, but literally used the handbook from the denazification process in Germany. It was held up as being the high watermark of are there elements of this film that relate to your experiences with the Rohingya people that you would like to speak to?
Yeah, every piece of this film really touched me, especially those words. The enemy, when they refer to the children of the Nazi, they say the enemy is blood inside them. Mm-hmm. That is the very same word they refer to the Rohingya children being burned by Myanmar militaries and the ultra-nationalist Buddhists. So just like the doctor said, it's like there is complicity in everywhere. Military leaders, they are like committing this crime against humanity, the genocide, and unfortunately, more than 40 years, the majority of the Burmese, they are brainwashed that these Rohingyas are illegal immigrants from Bangladesh, and there's no place for them. This is the national duty to eliminate them. And the lady, the Nobel Prize winner, she said in 2017, mass killing, you might remember that what she is saying, that when the villagers are burned, the whole family is burned alive, the girls are gang raped by militaries and ultra-nationalists. What she is saying that, she said this, there is no clearance operation happening in the region. That is what the Nobel Prize winner said about that. So I could, when I see the films also, I see that there is a lot of words which deny the Holocaust, so it's really remember me. And then another thing is the complicity. Even those human rights defenders in the country, whatever happened to the Rohingyas, they don't feel as it is a crime. They said that this is our fault, why we don't leave the country. So I feel like what I would like to say here is that genocide is not an accident. It is manufactured deliberately by the state. And when the state of, when the, how shall I say, final state of the genocide arrived, the most, the majority in the country, they are totally complicit. And also when you look at the international community, they are also complicit because the government, the state has strategically planned for, planned with its relationship with different country, EU, United States, the United States and North America, China. So to reduce the interference of international community, it's placed around with its other countries. So he can, the government can still do the, how shall I say, trade with trade for the natural resources, buying the weapons. At the same time, nobody, no country is willing to interfere. What is happening? Crime happenings in the country, and there's misleading information. There's one thing that the ladies, the Aung San Suu Kyi, she is a, everybody admire him, her, everybody respect her, and they just want to believe that Burma is now in on its road to the democracy, and this killing of the people, minority people, is just a small bump, inevitable. So, but the bump, what you see a small bump, is the life of the humans, is a baby is born alive. When I see the baby smashed to the car, I remember those Rohingya babies born alive in the fire when the mother is being gang raped. So these are the, yeah, it is an obstacle, but they are an obstacle for the democracy, but they are human lives, so you need to consider that. And another thing is that, please don't, it is not true that Burma is on its, how shall I say, its way to democracy. It's not true that the, it is, the government is the fascist, and it is, how shall I say, violating human rights in every place. But in the case of Rohingya, it is worse because Rohingya cannot move to any other place, and they are being blocked from all the resources and schooling, education, and health facility, everything. And these, the mass killing is happening there, and the whole country, the majority of the citizens are also brainwashed to believe that these people should be killed. I'm sorry.
No. Thank you, Zaitun. Sorpong, you have a different perspective, I suppose, a professional perspective or window on these questions, given that your focus is on security, and also you have a special interest or a special insight into Cambodia, where between a quarter to a third of the population was killed during the Cambodian atrocities. What in this film most caught your attention?
Talking about, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Talking about mass atrocities, by that I mean war crimes, crimes against humanity, ethnic cleansing, and genocide. When I watched the film, it brought back a lot of okay.
Sorry, it doesn't seem to
work. Is it working? Okay. All right. When I was watching the film, it brought back a lot of memories. No. It's close to my mouth already. Unless you want me to put it
there,
in the
side. There we go.
Okay. Now it brought back a lot of memory, especially when I, you know, think back to what happened in 1975. Some of you may have seen the film, The Killing Fields. Mm-hmm. When I saw that film when I was at the University of Waterloo, I thought I was there, back there. You know, I was close to finishing high school in 1975. So I was aware of what happened in Cambodia at the time. So the film just brought back a lot of memories, a lot of similarities, different contexts, different historical events, but there are some similarities, and I will talk about it later. So it brought me a lot of pain. I did not or have not watched the killing field ever again after that one time when I watched it. So when I watched this, it brought back a lot of memory. That's my first point, that it's real. We cannot deny the reality of what happened at Auschwitz or during World War II, not only in Europe, but also in the Far East. You know, I also study the International Military Tribunal in Nuremberg and also the Far East. So the Japanese war crimes, and crimes against humanity, you know? So it's just so difficult. And the second point I want to make, we can elaborate on this later on, but the second point I want to make is that the pursuit of justice is so complex. For me, the more I try to understand it, the less I understand it, because it's so complex. One of the challenges that I have because I teach international law as well as international security, so I try to understand the root causes of mass atrocity crime. But the pursuit of justice is not to me as simple as it looks. It's complicated, it's complex, life is complicated. I remember very vividly when the Khmer Rouge came to power in 1975, the first thing I remember was that we will make Cambodia a new Cambodia that is just and democratic. It's all about justice. The next thing I know is the massacre. The next thing I saw was my father was taken away to his execution. And then we were driven out of our house. So when the Khmer Rouge came in, it's all about peace, justice, and democracy. But then it turned out to be the killing fields. So the concept of justice is just very difficult for me. We can elaborate on it. That's the second impression I got from watching the movie, and that is the pursuit of justice is complex, very complex. The third point, I want to make it very briefly, where do we go from here? What have we learned? The International Tribunal, military tribunals in Nuremberg and the Far East did not really end mass atrocity crimes. The countries that were involved in defeating Nazi, the Nazi regime, the Soviet Union, was a good example, committed many atrocity crimes after that. During the Cold War alone, the socialist regime around the world were responsible for almost roughly 100 million people. 60 million in China, the Great Leap Forward, the Cultural Revolution, under Stalin, under Pol Pot, under other socialist regimes. So we have not really learned. And then the end of the Cold War, the former Yugoslavia, and then Rwanda, and also East Timor, also Sierra Leone and other parts of Africa, and ongoing in Myanmar. So we need to really think about what have we learned about this. And I will, you know, if I have a lot of time, I can talk more about my understanding of it. But these 3 points are based on what, you know, the impression I've got from watching the film.
Thank you. Well, I had quite a list of questions to go through. This is a dense subject. I'm going to ask one very difficult question in an unfairly short space of time for each of you before I open matters up to the questions from the floor. And that is, it leads on from, Sarapong, your closing remarks. At the end of the film, several of the people being interviewed spoke to the question of the extent to which the Holocaust has changed the vocabulary around mass atrocities, where everyone now recites the phrase, never again. And yet, nevertheless, atrocities keep happening again and again and again. And I am conscious, for example, as to take it on a much, much smaller scale, as Canadians, we condemn, for example, Saudi Arabia's actions in Yemen. We have denounced them at the UN High Human Rights Commission for killing civilians. We're also selling weapons to them, which are being used in that conflict. So my question is, do you think that the world really has learned anything from the events of the Holocaust? And to put it most starkly, if the events that led up to the Holocaust were to happen again today, do you think the Holocaust would be any less likely? I'll start with you, Zaitun.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, what I would like to say is that I will start with the meaning of forgiveness. What does the forgiveness mean? If there is no consequences, to forgive someone, forgive the perpetrator, the person who is guilty, they need to confess and they need to correct whatever they have done. So sometimes what happens is that if we cannot forgive, it is like people start to blame the victims for the original offense they have suffered. Like we don't want to reconcile. But where's your action? Have you confessed? Have you done anything to correct whatever crime you have committed? That's the first thing. And for the question, I'm feeling that there's two parts. The first part is there's two complicity. Inside Burma, there are small civil rights movement on the anti-Muslim prejudices, but they focus more on the anti-Muslim, not on the Rohingya. So it is very small, so there is complicity is happening inside the country. And the genocide is rooted in the exclusion of this Rohingya minority. So this exclusion need to be reversed if you would like to stop the genocide. So what we need is the support of the international community. But as I have said, as I has mentioned before, what is happening is that Myanmar government, they are using its relationship with different countries strategically so that there is less interference of EU and US. At the same time, they could do trade with the North Korea for buying the weapons and also the China selling the natural resources and buying the weapons. So it's like the most of the Western country and international community, they just want to believe that Burma is on its way to democracy and whatever happening to the Rohingyas, it is just a small matter. So this attitude, this belief need to be changed first to prevent further ongoing genocide.
Okay, thank you. A number of years ago, I published a journal article declaring that there were three miracles in East Asia. The first miracle was the East Asian economic miracle. The second miracle was the disappearing of mass atrocities in that part of the world. And then the third was that the Southeast Asian countries have transformed themselves into a community. They used to be enemies, then they became friends. That's how I characterized the relationship within ASEAN, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. But at the same time, I also warned that miracles can die quickly, simply because if political regimes are not democratic, there is a chance that kind of mass atrocity or political violence is likely to happen. Now, mass atrocity crimes happen in society or state that are so heavily militarized. Myanmar is very militarized. And during the period under the Khmer Rouge regime, it was highly militarized. I can talk all night about it. But I wouldn't want to get into it at the moment because of time constraint. But atrocities are not going to go away anytime soon. If you look at global trends, there is a book already, The End Times of Human Rights. And if you read every human rights report, it shows that the trends, global trend, have become very, very worrisome. The decline of liberal democracy, the rise of China as a dictatorship, and the new Cold War. A lot of atrocities were committed during great power politics or war or great power conflict. So countries like Cambodia was, you know, the conflict was known as a proxy war. And it was between China, United States, and all of that. So that's why I said that mass atrocity crimes happen in a very complex situation. But the world is not moving in the right direction. I'm sorry to say that, because I'm a student of world politics. And with a lot of paying a lot of attention to human rights and democracy. And I have to say that I am worried a lot. And the problem with mass atrocity, based on my research, maybe I have more time to talk about it. You can stop me if you want, because if you ask me to talk about this thing, I can keep going all night. That's my problem, because I'm passionate about it, because I, you know, suffer a lot during the Civil War and also my time in the killing fields and my time as a refugee running for my life. Finally came to Canada in the early 1980s. So I can talk a lot. But the three things that we should keep an eye on, maybe very quickly, okay? Ideological extremism. That's a very good indicator to me. Secondly, is extreme insecurity. Thirdly, is isolationism. I can talk more about it.
Thank you. Well, Rebecca, you had the first word before at the start. You'll get the last word before we open things up to the floor.
So you asked about the phrase "never again." That phrase, I think, served an extraordinarily important purpose, especially in the, you know, between the 60s and 70s and 80s, when Holocaust historians, largely Jewish historians, were trying to draw attention to the Holocaust. It certainly wasn't anywhere near a part of the discussion at Nuremberg. The mass killing of Jews was really not the focus of Nuremberg. That needs to be said as well. That was about war crimes and crimes against humanity, but the word Holocaust wasn't even used then. So really the idea of learning about this past in order to comprehend it and in order to prevent it from happening again had a very powerful and important meaning for historians who wanted to bring attention to what was happening. In the meantime, I think it is a very empty slogan, to be honest, and it gets thrown around very often, and this is one of the things that I think about a lot, as an empty phrase that makes people feel better to think that they're doing something. Unfortunately, it's quite obvious that nobody really does anything on any scale without there being a particular national interest. Humanitarian intervention does not happen for purely humanitarian reasons, ever. It certainly didn't happen during what was very clearly happening to the Jews in Europe during the Second World War, which the Allies certainly knew was happening, and it hasn't happened since. Nobody intervenes without some kind of national self-interest. It's a very depressing fact of global politics, not just today, but in the 40s as well. So my feeling is, you know, it sounds awfully naive and optimistic and utopian, but it begins all with education. The only radical shift that can happen through education, and there has to be the will for that to happen. Otherwise, it's very...
Well, I have to say, in the sort of work that my colleagues and I do at Mosaic, you have to be a pathological optimist, and we are. Mm-hmm. sometimes even that pathology can be tested. But we'll now open matters up to the floor. There's one microphone on the ground floor, one microphone in the balcony. If you have a question for the panel, please step forward. I should also mention that if you have not put your name in for the ballot or the draw for a book by Ed Bertinsky, one of the Mosaic Institute's peace patrons that we're giving away at the end of the evening, the window of opportunity on greatness is about to close, so please do find my colleague and drop your card in his box. Start with the first question on the floor.
I'm 70, and I see my premier posing with a neo-Nazi. I see the leading candidate for the prime minister position posing with neo-Nazi groups, refusing to distance themselves or call them out, and attacking our educational process. So here we are in Canada, the good, now what?
I should mention that Mosaic is a non-partisan institution. But your question is a fair one. I will throw it open to the panel. Who would like to take that one?
I don't know if it was a question as much as it was a statement of despair, which I share. Of course, there is something very important about free speech, but I think it's also important to note one of the aspects of the film that you might have seen. When this elderly woman, Frau Haverbeck, starts denying the Holocaust, she's immediately told, you're going to be charged now. And that has to do with the fact that it is illegal to deny the Holocaust in Germany. And it is illegal to have a swastika visible on you in Germany. This is one of the steps that's taken as a result of the horror of the past, that there are certain fundamental lines that cannot be crossed. That looks very different in North America and leads to a situation, and again, I keep referring to it as a slippery slope, where certain interests are allowed to speak their minds. And it's very, very troubling, obviously, to watch it. It's especially troubling to listen to rhetoric that rears its head, not just in North America, but in Germany now as well. And that, to me, is one of the more alarming aspects of this whole history, because ultimately, Germany has done kind of an unbelievably successful job of confronting its past. It comes late. It does not come in the 60s or the 70s. It comes more in the 80s and 90s in Germany. But really, there's no place on earth that deals with its past the way that Germany has, including building a memorial the size of two football fields in the center of its capital to its own mass atrocity. It just doesn't happen anywhere else. One of the other things that happens is that people like Angela Merkel decide that they're going to make a very conscious effort to bring in millions of refugees, which is what they did, 1.5 million, as a direct consequence of the Nazi past. What you see now in Germany, though, is a very alarming and strong backlash to that, with a rise, slow rise, of a very clever right that has grown its hair back and taken off its jackboots and now appears in parliament. And these kinds of trends are alarming, and they need to be warned against.
Thank you. Thank you. I believe there's a question from the balcony.
Can I just respond to that for a second?
No. Sure.
No, I'm someone who believes very strongly in education. That's why I'm a professor. But education is not enough. I always ask people, what kind of education do we have? What does education help us achieve? For me, at the end of the day, you have to really care about our democracy. I think it's very important. Make sure that democratic institutions do not break down. Because once democratic institutions break down, you know, anything can go. How do we really help strengthen our democratic institution? I think one of the problems that I have seen today is, I'm sad to say, and you may disagree with me completely, and you know what I say may be offending, but identity politics has become a bit out of control, in the United States in particular. When one side demonizes each other, when accusations are thrown around trying to criminalize, so to speak, each other, that worries me. Because in Cambodia, my experience is that once the regime or anyone started to label someone as criminal or as enemy or as morally evil, there is a backlash. Rebecca hit the nail on the head in the sense that when you have immigration coming and people see it as a threat. That's why I'm more interested in security problem. Immigration is a security problem that needs to be addressed constructively. By trying to accuse people of being racist and things like that, we fail to understand the underlying fear of strangers coming and by demonizing that, you don't address the problem. So I think it's important to understand the causes that lead to people hate and anger and all of that. And that can only come through understanding how people feel. I would say when I studied the Khmer Rouge regime, the greatest source of all evil in that period was not the desire to build a classless utopian society. Not as simple as that. But because of the intense perception of insecurity and threat to the regime that led to a lot of killing. So we need to be very careful about demonizing anyone. We need to really bring people together, find middle ground so people can understand each other. And that's what worries me. That's my opinion.
Thank you. I'm afraid that we are rubbing up against the schedule of films in the cinema, so I'll need to draw things to a close. Before I do so, I'd like to thank the panelists for joining us, for volunteering their time to be with us and their expertise. And most of all, I'd like to thank each of you for being in the audience today, for being participants in this discussion. If I may be allowed a brief editorialization myself, and really, who's going to stop me? One of the things that left an impression on me about this film, there was a lot of focus on the question of, was it right? Is it right? Is it appropriate to hold responsible someone who is an accountant or a chef or a janitor for being a cog in the machine that kills large numbers of people, that commits mass atrocities? I think there's another side to that, and that is that at the end of the day, these atrocities are only possible because of the complicity of ordinary people. And that while it is easy and appropriate to point to the leaders, we also have to be willing to hold up a mirror to ourselves and ask whether the currents that swept through countries that eventually committed mass atrocities in which vast numbers of people were complicit are not currents that exist in many societies and in some way, shape, or form exist in our own society. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, I do agree that the phrase never again is often used as a cliche and as a hollow substitute for real thought and real reflection. Mm-hmm. But if it's to be meaningful, it's only because we as individuals, as well as a society, decide it will never happen again. So now, we'll now hold our draw for the Ed Bertinsky book. Zaitun, would you like to draw? You look like you have an honest face.
Joanne Harvey.
Is Joanne Harvey here? Congratulations, Joanne. My colleague Akshay will provide you with a book. To everyone else, thank you for staying for the panel discussion. Thank you for coming here this evening. And thank you for your contributions.